Okay, so we pretty much know that it's already extremely awkward that I'm recording myself, but it's the most efficient way to get this project to the point and still have what I need to fit the criteria. So with that said and out of the way, let's get started. So the type of poetry we're going to go over is images. According to PoetrySoup.com, images are mostly young poets that worked in England and America in the early 20th century. They rejected Romantic and Victorian conventions and favored precise imagery and clear, non-elevated language. In other words, they were young writers that didn't necessarily favor the big words, and they liked to write their poems to the point. They wanted their readers to understand their message clearly in a thoroughly thought-out poem. PoemHunter.com says that imagism is a reaction to the Victorian and Georgian poets. According to Images.org, images held three principles: direct treatment of the subject, allow no word that was not essential to the presentation, and follow the musical phrase rather than the strict regularity in their rhythms. Hilda Doolittle was born on September 10, 1886 in Bethlehem, Pennsylvania, according to Images.org. With her mother a Moravian and her father an astronomer, she grew up to be what some have called the finest of all Images poets. She did branch out much farther than just Little Images poems, but we won't get into that. She has earned many awards such as gold medal from the American Academy of Arts and Letters and the Brandeis and Longview Awards. Through many of her different accomplishments of her work and different lovers she's been through, Doolittle has traveled to many places, seen many things, has been inspired, and has been inspiring. She unfortunately had a stroke in July of 1961, then later passed away on September 27th. Okay, so the poem we're going to analyze from Hilda Doolittle is called Heat. O wind, rend open the heat, cut apart the heat, rend it to tatters. Fruit cannot drop through this thick air. Fruit cannot fall into heat that presses up and blunts the points of pears and rounds of the grapes. Cut the heat, plow through it, turning it on either side of your path. Just by looking at the title, the reader already knows that the poem is going to be on the heat. This poem is very simplistic and is quite easy to pull the meaning out. Let's look at the first stanza. O wind, rend open the heat, cut apart the heat, rend it to tatters. The speaker is talking about the wind relieving him of the hot air. He wants the wind to come through and make the heat seem as though it is not there, or at least more bearable, by cutting it into smaller pieces. The speaker goes on to say, fruit cannot drop through this thick air. Fruit cannot fall into heat that presses up the blunts, the points of the pears, and rounds of the grapes. He is simply saying that fruit doesn't grow very well in hot weather. He is saying that the fruit can't drop because they are unable to become ripe enough. It is simply too hot for the fruit to grow properly, and the heat is causing them to become warped and practically inedible anymore. The fruits have blunts, and they are developing imperfections. The tip of the pears are soft and the grapes aren't round and plump. Doolittle ends her poem with, cut the heat, plow through it, turning it on either side of your path. In this last stanza, Doolittle almost personifies the wind. The speaker wants the heat to go away and disappear. He would like the wind to push the heat away, almost like a person pushing their way through a crowd, pushing everyone on either side of them and out of their pathway. One of Doolittle's friends as a young lady was Ezra Pound. They met at the University of Pennsylvania, and they had a bit of romance together, but it ended when Doolittle's father refused permission for them to get married in the summer of 1907. Pound, too, is a poet known for his Images poems. According to PoemHunter.com, Pound was an American expatriate poet and critic and a major figure in early modernist movement in poetry. He became known for his role in developing Imagism. According to PoetryHunter.com, Pound was born in Haley, Idaho Territory on October 30, 1885, and was the only child of Homer Pound and Isabel Weston. Both parents' ancestors had emigrated from England in the 17th century. Isabel Pound was unhappy living in Haley, according to PoetryHunter.com, and when Azura Pound was 18 months old, she left with him to go back east. Homer Pound followed them, got a job, and then, in July of 1893, they bought a six-bedroom house in the town of Winecote, Pennsylvania. Ezra Pound knew that he wanted to become a poet very early on. Pound published his first poem when he was only 11 years of age on November 7, 1896. Pound was admitted to the University of Pennsylvania's College of Liberal Arts in 1901 at the age of 15. Later, he met Hilda Doolittle, like I mentioned earlier. He attended a few colleges and universities throughout his lifetime, and he earned a few awards as well. In spring of 1906, he registered as a PhD student to write a thesis on the gestures in Lope de Vega's plays, and he was awarded a Harrison Fellowship and a travel grant of $500, according to PoetryHunter.com. He loved to travel, especially to Europe, and in 1972, the day after his birthday, he was admitted to Civil Hospital of Venice and then later died on November 1st in his sleep of an intestinal blockage. The poem I chose to analyze from Ezra Pound is called Ancient Music. Winter is a-comin' in, lutes sing goddamn, raineth drop and staineth slop, and how the wind doth ram, sing goddamn. Skiddeth bus and sloppeth us, an ague hath my ham, freezeth river, turneth liver, damn you sing goddamn. Goddamn, goddamn, tis why I am, goddamn, so against the winter's balm, sing goddamn, damn, sing goddamn, sing goddamn, sing goddamn, damn. This poem is actually a parody of a medieval English rhoda called Summer is a-comin' in. In this one, the speaker happily sings about the arrival of spring. In Pound's parody of this piece, the speaker dreads the thought of the winter coming. Let's start with the first stanza. Winter is a-comin' in, lewd sing goddamn, rain is drop and stain is slop, and how the wind doth ram, sing goddamn. The speaker explains that winter is coming and he loudly sings goddamn because of it. He continues by stating that winter is when the rain pours, stains occur, and the winds are stronger than ever, and this is why he sings goddamn. Pound continues his poem by writing, skiddeth bus and sloppeth us, an ague hath my ham, freezeth the river, turneth liver, damn you sing, goddamn. This first line of the stanza talks about when the bus skids on the side of the road and how the water from the gutters will spray anyone on the sidewalk. Ague is a fever or anything that will make someone shiver, so when the poem says an ague hath my ham, it means that a fever will come upon the speaker from the weather. The rivers will freeze over and the speaker's liver may feel as if it is turned over because of the cold. Goddamn, goddamn, tis why I am, goddamn, so against the winter's balm. This stanza is quite easy to translate. The speaker sings goddamn because of all these things, and this is why he is against the winter's coming. Sing goddamn, damn, sing goddamn, sing goddamn, sing goddamn, damn. Pound ends his poem with this last stanza, which means that because of all these events that happen in the wintertime, the speaker hates when winter comes and he sings, well, goddamn. Well, I hope my analyses helped you understand Hilda Doolittle and Ezra Pound a little better. Hopefully I guided you to understand the concept of Imagist poems as well. Thanks for listening!